Thank you for the opportunity to presenting for presenting a talk. Although my title says action dark matter, I don't think I'm going to say anything new about from the dark matter's action dark matter perspective. But I'm going to talk about a new probe that can be done using the gravitation wave interferometer based techniques that we have from this kind of action and action dark matter kind of probes. And I'm going to briefly spend some time about some UV completion detection regarding that action sector and testability with respect to that. This is the outline of my talk. Just I will briefly sketch over some sources of gravitation wave from cosmic origin. Many of them have been described. I mean, there have been also other talks based on that, especially the talks before me by Raghavendra and Nilanjan, and there will be also talks tomorrow. So I'm not going to spend time on that. Then I'm going to talk about Pecci-Quinn phase transition, which is a stochastic background gravitational wave and the ways to which can we can detect it. And then I'm going to talk about a particular model following the UV completion principle of asymptotic freedom principle. Then probably I don't have time to go into the nanometer projection, then I will conclude my talk. So this is just a sketch of the history of the early universe. I mean, must have seen this a ton of times. We have inflation, and then we go into the radiation dominated area, then CMB, and then stars to form and the galaxies. Okay, so gravitation wave was first detected in 2016. It's a new window of early universe, particularly so in terms of particle physics. With laboratory-based experiment, we cannot go beyond TV, but gravitation wave allows us to go to energy scales beyond TV, particularly in terms of cosmological history, pre-Big Bang nucleosynthesis history. There are many sources of gravitation wave of cosmic origin. There can be primordial in gravitation wave, secondary gravitation wave induced by first order of scalar perturbations, then phase transitions, reheating graviton radiation from inciton, topological defect, and many more. And strong CP problem, which has a U1C symmetry, also dictates we have some kind of Pecci-Quinn phase transition. So just a preliminary on gravitation wave, you write the background metric in this form, and then you perturb around it. These are your gravitational degrees of freedom propagating. And this is the equation which governs the propagation. On the right hand side, there is some anisotropic term which is acts like a viscosity and which also sources the propagation, and the gravitational wave degrees of freedom solution looks something like this, which has the Fourier transform. Okay, some examples of gravitational waves. So topological defects like cosmic string, which can form from very symmetry breaking in early universe, gives you a spectrum like this. On the y-axis, I show the plot of gravitational wave amplitude. On the x-axis is the frequency. You can see this spectrum. Typical spectrum of cosmic strings is almost scale invariant. And then there will be other sources which were also discussed earlier. This is a source from scalar induced. The spectrum looked like this. These are other sources from preheating of cosmic origin. The spectrum looks like some of this. This is from Bremsstrahlung. So the idea is that different origins of gravitational wave from cosmological perspective will give you different spectrum of gravitational wave. And this helps us to distinguish between various events and correspondingly phenomenology. So this is the message I wanted to convey, showing the various spectrum. So coming to phase transition, what happens is that if you do quantum field theory in finite temperature, you can play with a scalar potential. And if you do temperature correction, which are basically one loop corrections or quantum correction in a photon bath, then your potential gets deformed in this manner. And and if there is a barrier created between two different minima, then this thermal barrier can give you phase transition. The height of the barrier gives you the energy density that is released in the universe and can be thought of as the gravitational wave background. In the standard model, it is not possible with standard model Higgs because of the masses of the W and Z particles that we found out, but it is possible in the PSM scenario. these are some simulations that people have done. So when the bubbles nucleate, expand in the plasma, have nonlinear turbulence effect. I don't want to go into the details of that. Just to summarize how to take into account, the gravitational wave has three sources, one from bubble wall collision, one from sound wave that is left behind in the plasma, and another is the magnetohydrodynamics effect, which are nonlinear in nature. Each of them has its own characteristics spectrum. These are the parameters which I'm going to talk about right now. So the two most important parameters are the alpha, which is basically the amount of radiation that is given out in terms of gravitational wave background, you can say from the thermal energy to gravitational energy, and it is basically normalized with respect to some critical radiation from Sanamal. But beta basically governs the rate at which this phase transition happens or the bubble nucleation happens. The longer the beta, the stronger the phase. You can have the phase transition affecting, and basically you just need to solve for the bounce action with this typical Euclidean action in three-dimensional space, which is the one which governs the model you put in. You put in any kind of potential which governs this kind with its temperature corrected. You will have this in terms of this alpha beta. And T star is basically the temperature at which this bubble nucleation happens. There are other parameters which are related to the simulation, etc., which also takes into account the details which are related to bubble burst speed and efficiency factor of the same process. This is just an example of how to calculate this kind of bounce action. So I don't have the time to go into details. So, okay, so just to say a few words, how these parameters controls the phase transition. So this is the typical spectrum. The alpha basically controls the height, which is the energy density released. So it basically controls the amplitude of the gravitational waves. T star or the nucleation temperature controls the frequency at which this phase transition will happen. And the job of beta is just some amount of scaling in both this direction. And this is how you affect the whole gravitational wave spectrum for given any. And this is a plot of one of the interferometer, space-based interferometers, gravitational wave sensitivity plot that we can detect. So if it is within this region, you can say that there is a possibility of detecting. Okay, so the strong CP problem is well known. We have had many discussions in this workshop. It is just to get rid of this fine-tuning of the value of that we can have for the CPC validating time and strong sector. There are classical models of this doing this involving a scalar field where DFAZ action and KSVZ action. I'll just for the time being stick to KSVZ action and talk about how the Pacheco infestation can happen there. So this is also what we also have discussed many times, how the action can act as a cold dark matter. This is basically the vacuum misalignment mechanism. Let me just skip it for the time check. Okay. So action and action-like particles are always suppressed by inverse powers of the symmetry breaking scale. This scalar, I write it, the radial part of the scalar will give me the oscillation and the phase transition around the minima. And this, I write it in this manner, the phase will solve the strong CP problem. And if it's strongly first order, we can have gravitational wave signals from it. So this is how the total potential looks like. This is my three-level potential. This is my one-loop corrected potential, given the particle spectrum of a particular model. And this is the temperature corrected, finite temperature corrected, given the Mohr model, which are affected by the extra scalars or the extra fermions that you put in it. And then if you do the whole thing, then if you calculate the bounce action and do the gravitational wave amplitude, the result that is typically have on the plane of the very general action like particle search in the plane of action to dive photon to, let's say, the mass of the action, this is for the action like particle, is this. So you can see, you can superimpose the bound from gravitational wave, LISA, BBO, advanced LIGO are the bounds from the interferometer based gravitational waves detectors. And these are the other bounds that we had many discussions. Some of them are astrophysical bounds, some of them are laboratory bounds. And you can see that there is a scope of probing the Pacheco phase transition that given a particular model. And this is just different types of gravitational wave detector that are being planned. And this is the scale of the action, Pecci Quint phase transition that you can prose. You can see some of them are within the classical QCD action range. And this is what we can discuss a bit from here. So, okay. So for the QCD-like action, there is fermion contribution from the V effective. The potential is corrected of this form. You can see if it's a, it receives a thermal mass with the quartic coupling, it is usually, if you do it, it's of the second order. However, if you do it, if you break the Pecci-Quint symmetry radiatively, you have this kind of relation which behaves like a scaling event. That that means this phase transition lasts for a long time, and you can have a very strong first order phase transition if you have a conformal symmetry. Or else you can also do by other kind of strong coupling, going to strong coupling regime or extra dimension, where also you can make it the Pecci-Quint phase transition strong. So if you do it by radiative breaking, which is having a conformal symmetry, as I showed you, there is a conformal symmetry being big because of this, the S3 by T becomes constant, which means it's a scalar invariant conformal symmetry. Then you have this symmetry breaking, the flat direction is lifted at one loop, and you have a huge energy density released in terms of the height of the potential as a background. In the terms of the plane of the gravitational wave amplitude versus frequency, it lies somewhere like here, given suitable values of this beta. And you can see in some of the regions are within the LIGO best detectors, and in future Einstein detection will be better detected. Okay, so now just before I conclude, I talk about a particular model which is related to UV completion of different particle physics model. It is known as total asymptotic free freedom. The principle is that all couplings, the gauge couplings, the quartic couplings, the Yukawa couplings in the theory, I want it to go to zero in the UV. And I want my theory to be valid up to infinite energy. I want it to be perturbative. And I want all the quantum corrections to vanish in the UV. So if you follow this principle, then of course you cannot have Landau poles in your theory. You have to replace all your U1s by some non-abelian group, the simplest being SU2. And general conditions for all kinds of standard model, extensions of standard model, grand extensions of grand unified models, the conditions with total asymptotic has been studied by many authors. And here, for simplicity, we just stick to this U1 being replaced by SU2. And try to see what can be the predictions from phase transition in this model. So just a disclaimer, gravitational corrections are not included. So also because it might become important since we are claiming the theory to be valid up to infinite energy beyond grand unified scale, or beyond Planck scale, beyond Landau's Pohl scale. But we also think that the gravitational corrections are softened because Einstein gravity itself it is not renormalizable. So some extended gravity theories, typical example these days very popular are quadratic gravity, and people have shown that gravitational corrections can become softened in the UV, and it might not become important in the particle physics context. This is my spectrum of the theory. When you replace SU1 by SU2, I get a dark photon, and all the terms I can express in terms of FA, which is a Pecci-Quint breaking space. Okay. So how does my quantum corrections look like? These are the quantum corrections of the gauge theory. I think in terms of some extra corrections, delta, this delta contributions from the model that you take. So for example, KSVZ model, you will have contributions from scalars and fermions in the theory. This is just some way of writing my scale. So with a particular energy scale T, this energy scale can be my Pecci-Quint breaking scale. And my total asymptotic freedom condition will dictate what are the values or what are the benchmark values you can have for which all couplings vanish in the UV. So this is my potential. As you can see, there are only few parameters which are free, which I'm going to show you next. And these are the RRG. So I take the condition that all my couplings, the quartic, the gauge, and the Yukawa should flow to zero in the infinite energy, UV. And this will give you predictions in terms of this GS and the FA that is there in my theory. And
Nish, I'm sorry, I'm going to have to ask you to conclude soon just to respect the time limit. I apologize.
Yeah, sure.
1 more
so
minute.
So this is the plot. You can see all the gauge couplings flow to zero. This is a plot of energy scale entry per 200, entry per 400. I mean, it will be zero after soon, beyond the Landau-Post scale. These are some of the values, benchmark values that you can take. Just to go into the business plot, in the parameter space of the nucleation temperature, and the beta, these are the different gravitational wave detectors which you can probe. These are the predictions which can be made. We also impose conformal symmetry baking. What conformal symmetry baking does is gets rid of this mass tree level mass term, so your theory becomes more predictive and the phase transition is strong. Okay, so just to conclude, this is the central plot. You can see with these predictions, you will going to have the total asymptotic freedom condition. Your theory is related up to infinite energy, and you will get the prediction of the gravitational wave in this region. These are the very interferometer based particularly detectors. And I conclude with this slide. Gravitational wave detector will be probing pre-BBN era. UV completion action models is insensitive to laboratory or astrophysics, but it will be predictable in early universe dynamic gravitational wave from strong phase to the achieving phase transition will be testable in near future. Conformal symmetry breaking helps to make the phase transition very, very strong. So basically, I didn't get time to discuss, but this basically is super cool cooling, and this super cooling induces high amplitude gravitational wave. TUF principle predicts very characteristics and verifiable gravitational waves, and gravitational wave era is an invitation to dare propose and test UV completion models of quantum field theory and gravity. Thank you. Sorry.
Thank you, Anish. Thank you very much. So I'm going to take one quick question, and then if there are any more, please just feel free to look on the chat and ask privately and answer privately. So the question is from Ajit Srivastava, and it is, does one consider gravitational wave from shock waves if bubble walls are supersonic?
Yes, I mean, of course, there are details related to that, but once you have this huge, so you can see we have a huge supercooling in this region. So this supercooling basically acts like a second inflation, because this is a huge energy density that you are pumping out in the background universe, and this happens basically in a vacuum. So you have another reheating which is happening, and most of the things happen in vacuum, and since it's a vacuum, the other contributions that you are saying are almost negligible from sound wave and magnetohydrodynamics. But yes, and I mean, there are details that one can take into account. But mostly the contribution is dominated from bubble nucleation rate.
Very good. Thank you. Thank you very much, Anish. And we are going to move on now with the last talk of this session.